This is Mike with the One-Stop Co-op Shop, and today I've got another Kickstarter preview for you. This one is Beyond the Rift, which is a Perdition's Mouth spin-off game. It's an adventure card game instead of a dungeon crawler. This one has solo and cooperative play for up to four players, and like most adventure card games, it's usually better with at least two players to have some cooperation, so I'm going to do a two-handed playthrough. I'll start out with a brief summary of the rules, then do the full playthrough, and end with my impressions of the game so far. So feel free to use the chapters, the timestamps, to skip to any of that. And if you enjoy our content at the One-Stop Co-op Shop, lots of ways to get involved. You can support us on Patreon, join the conversation on our Discord, check out our streaming channel, or listen to our weekly podcast. So there are four heroes in the game. I'm using Bastion, kind of a tank, and Eliza, a wizard for my two. And each one has a completely unique deck of action cards. And they've got this player board, and the main thing is they'll be tracking their action points here. And of course, everything is a prototype. This is a random token I had lying around. And over here, they have details on the character's special abilities, and also what they can do with their action points beyond playing cards. Then you've got this tracking board over here. The big thing is the threat tracker at the bottom. Each of the quests is going to use threat differently, but usually it increases by one at the end of each round. In the case of this quest, we're doing the first one in the main campaign, where orcs are trying to chase us down and kill us, so we just have to survive a certain number of rounds and we win. And speaking of those orcs, you have cards to represent the enemies. They've got stats at the bottom, their attack stats on the left, and they can either be in the quest area, which is kind of like at long range from your characters, or through players engaging them or the enemy's own activations, they can get into your own hero area and threaten you there. Now, the first part of each round is the hero phase. You're going to have a number of cards based on player count with two heroes. Each of them has six as their hand size. And to show you what's going on with the card, they each have a range value up here, which is going to be one or two. One means it can only affect you and enemies engage with you. Two means it can affect anybody. The symbols over here will give you a hint as to the card's types and effects. This one is a defense or action point kind of resting regain card. And some cards will show a highlighted body point here, in this case, the head. Each character has five spots, their head, left arm, right arm, body, and legs. And that goes into the upgrade system because this is a branching campaign game, although I'm just playing at the beginning, so I won't have any of these yet. But when you find items during the campaign, like this Scythian axe, one character would keep it and they would take the three cards that are for, I guess this is their right hand, based on which way you look at it. They would take the three cards from their deck, get rid of them, and replace them with these axe cards. So as you level up, you kind of change the composition of your deck. But during the hero phase, players can alternate actions freely. So Eliza could do a couple things, and then Bastion could do something, and then back to Eliza. And the options in the middle here are somewhat consistent among characters with some differences. So Eliza can pay three action points, just sliding the slider down to draw an extra card. She can pay one to discard up to two cards and draw replacements, and she can defend herself. Bastion's mostly the same. He can defend himself for cheaper. He can gain extra action points, which Eliza can't do, and he's a little bit worse at discarding. But besides those basic actions, what you can do in your hero phase is determined by your cards. So defense actions are reactive. You can play these when you get attacked to give yourself a better chance of defending. And these action point actions are pretty simple. You just play them to regain action points, be able to do more on your turn. Anytime you see this symbol, you're going to draw a response card. And by the way, if you've played Perdition's Mouth or seen our videos on it, then a lot of the stuff will look familiar. So these have values from -1 to 5, and they kind of average out to around 2. They're mostly used by enemies to randomize their attack and defense values, but as you saw, some player cards use them too. They're also kind of like these magical power cards. Those have a special effect that are pretty unique. And then the main one, and the only one that's somewhat complicated, is attacking. And a key thing with attacking cards is to look at whether they have a red or a blue action point value. Something like Blazing Winds has both, but other effects will only have one. And this, by the way, for all the actions is how many action points you have to spend to play the card and then discard it for its effect. So the difference between the red and the blue values, you have to play a red card first. That's like the primary attack, but then you can boost it with as many blue card effects as you want. So I could play Blazing Winds to start the attack, but then add on a Torrent of Fire, which would add it up to 7 action points. In this case, it wouldn't increase the attack value at all because you total up the red fist values, but it would give it an extra effect where I can just blast a ton of enemies all at once. Now, additionally, for attacks, for action points, for defense, other players can aid you, but the range has to be right. So generally speaking, you need 2 range to affect another character, unless you're like aiding their ranged attack against an enemy in front of you, and then you would need 1 range. But the key thing is when you aid, you only look at the value, you ignore any of the special text, and you have to pay the red value. So like if it's an attack card that's only blue, you can only play that to boost your own attacks, not to aid somebody else. After the players have decided they've played all the cards they want and don't want to spend any more action points, and you generally want to play most of your cards and most of your action points, as you'll see. You go to the enemy phase, which is pretty simple. They have this chart of how enemies activate for the scenario. I imagine these will be cards in the final version. And you draw a random response card, you look at the column, and you go from top to bottom, so all the skirmishers will either engage or attack if they're already engaged. Engage just means getting to range one. The Huntmaster will support people, the archers will attack, so pretty straightforward stuff to resolve. Then you have the spawn phase that's based on threat. In this scenario, it's just going to be a bunch of enemies coming out, and they're shooting arrows at us, so every once in a while we'll have to deal with a barrage where we all get attacked. Then the heroes have the draw phase. First, they reset their action points. They always go to their minimum value, like for Eliza, that's 5, and then they additionally get +1 action point for each card they still had left in their hand. So if you do less on your turn, you'll have more resources to do more stuff next time. Then regardless of how many cards you have left in your hand, you draw your hand size again, so 6, and then discard down to your hand size. So keeping cards gives you more options for what you'll do the next turn. And then finally, you have the end phase. Again, this is going to change from scenario to scenario, but for this one, you just increase the threat by 1. And again, we're just trying to get to a certain threat value. For 2 players, we have to get to threat 6, and then we win. And one more quick thing, and then we should be good to go. When an attack is successful, which means it has to beat the enemy's defense. And for enemies, they have a base attack and base defense stat. For players, you have to play those defensive cards to gain defense. And as I mentioned, enemies always draw a response card to increase their attack or defense. But if you beat a defense, you draw a card from this wound deck. For enemies, you slot it underneath their card, and it will affect their statistics. And the big one is it'll take away from their health, and if they ever go down to 0 health, they die. But for heroes, the wounds go straight into your hand, and you can play them for the actions indicated. So like here with this bruise, I can play it during an attack to do -2 to the attack. But the key thing is when you do that for attacks or defense or action points, you can't bring the attack down to 0. You can't basically make it a wasted attack just to get rid of your bruise. Now, if heroes don't play these cards to get rid of them, they'll build up because they count as cards in your hand. You can never discard them. And if you ever have your entire hand, like your entire hand size, 6, filled with wounds or these fatigue cards, which are a little bit easier to get rid of, then you die. And in this scenario, that means an instant loss. All right, so let's get into it and see if we can survive. So first, to quickly touch on my character's unique powers. For Eliza, or Elisa, she gains 2 action points for each card left in her hand at the end of the turn instead of 1, so she'll often go up to kind of ridiculous action point levels. And Bastion, as you can imagine, is a strong defender. Whenever he gets hurt, he gets to get an attack card from his discard pile back into his hand. And similarly, when he blocks an attack, he can discard another defense to get an attack card back. So he kind of keeps on bringing his attacks back as he gets hurt or blocks. As for our enemies, the Huntmaster has the worst damage statistic. He can do 3 damage to us, but he tends to just deal with the other guys. He doesn't actually attack us himself very often. The skirmishers are very tough melee opponents, and the archer is a nasty ranged attacker, although with not great defense. So often, if the skirmishers are in the quest area, they won't attack us that turn. They'll charge at us. And sometimes, if the orc archer is engaged with us, he won't attack us either. So you can kind of deal with them range-wise that way. So let's see, first of all, what Eliza has available. So her big thing for attacking, because we need to do a lot of that in this scenario, is that she has very few red attack cards, like those starter cards that she needs to actually attack, but pretty amazing blue boosting cards. Like this Torrent of Fire one lets her attack 3 enemies in the same area, so she can do kind of a 3-for-1 attack. But a lot of her cool spells mean that the attack can't be aided, so she has to do it herself. And right now, with her only having this 2 and nothing else, it's a little bit tough. She has like these fireball cards that add +5 attack that she really needs here. Bastion, on the other hand, is a pretty balanced guy, has really good attacks. One of his coolest abilities is that a lot of his attack cards let you add attack after you see the draw. So he's a great one for those players who are afraid of like mitigation and missing their attacks. And he also has a lot of ways to tank for and block for and defend his friends, and he has like leadership abilities to help them. So let's have Bastion go first and maybe pull that orc archer to start attacking him. So to engage an enemy, there's this value in the bottom left. For the orc archer, it's 2. If you pay that many action points, you can pull them into your area or disengage and send them back to the quest area. Bastion will pay 2 to do just that. There's our friend the orc. And he'll go ahead and do a surprise cut. It's 1 action point for a 4 attack. And if things don't go well, he can throw in the veteran's touch to finish it off. So the orc only has 1 defense, but we have to flip a card. +2 is 3, and you have to be greater than their defense. 4 is greater than 3, so he takes 1 wound card. And in this case, he's easier to engage and disengage with. It didn't affect his range, which is unfortunate, because if you take out an archer's range, they often can't do anything to you. He has -2 attack, -2 defense, and 1 wound, so not dead yet. And any card you play is discarded. I might be able to leave that guy for now. He's engaged with me, so he's probably not going to be able to do much. Although I still have Block and Slam and the Veteran's Touch to boost it, and now that guy's defense is worse, so why not go for it? That's another action point. That was a 3 base attack. Their statistics can't go below 0, so he has 0 defense. Plus 1, nice, I didn't need to boost it at all. And I think every wound card always causes at least 1 damage, so I just don't even draw one when they take their last one. So Orc Archer is defeated. And I'm not too worried about the Skirmishers unless they get the exact right response card. They're probably just going to charge at me and not attack this turn, at least that's what I hope. So do I want to do anything else yet? Well, the thing is, you always want to spend all your action points because they reset no matter what, whereas keeping cards isn't always the worst thing. So let's have Bastion spend 3 action points to draw a card, see if anything else comes up. When he got a nice attack, Shield Bash. And he's out of action points, but Defensive Stance could get him 3 more. Fade could get him a random number more. So let's go over to Eliza and see if she wants to do anything. Yes, her big issue is she doesn't have a big attack boosting card, so she doesn't really want to use her Blazing Winds. She's got Telekinesis and Theatrical Trick to defend herself. Smoke means people won't be able to target her unless they're in her area, so it would be great if we still had some archers to shoot at us. And Mind Control can cancel an enemy attacking her, so I want to definitely save 2 action points for that, I think. But for now, I think, yeah, for 1 action point, she can discard up to 2 cards and redraw. I don't think the smoke is going to help too much, and I don't think she needs 2 defense cards. Let's get rid of 1 of them. And I draw replacements, a dramatic attack, another booster, but with no actual attack value, and another basic attack. Dang, I want one of those fireballs. And I could do that again, but I'm worried I won't have enough action points to actually, like, use the stuff I get. So let's be a little wacky and set myself up for next turn. Spend 3 action points to draw another card. Yes, I'm above my hand size, but I think he can do that during the turn. I might be wrong about that. And that way she'll have a ton of action points next turn and be able... Oh, wait, hold on. That's right, I wanted Mind Control in case she gets attacked. So never mind. She'll just sit with what she has, I think. Bastion, I feel like Bastion should keep on going, right? Maybe hit the Huntmaster. Although, gosh, that guy's just 4 to engage. Never mind, let's just both sit and really have big turns next turn. Hopefully we won't get hurt too much. All right, so we've got 3 enemies in the quest area and a 3 activation for him. Looking here, the Skirmisher are going to engage and attack. You'll see if we had a 0, 1, or 2, or a 4. Jesus, we really got the only card that would do that? And then the Huntmaster is going to support archers, and all archers disengage. Man, there are no archers, which means he's going to attack too. This is like the worst possible card we could have gotten. So when you have multiple targets for an enemy, like in this case, the Skirmishers could engage and attack either of us. They have this target priority. So first is the person with the fewest enemies in their engagement area, then the person with the fewest cards in hand, and then the most wounds. So neither of us has any enemies engaged, but Bastion has 5 cards, Eliza has 6, so the first Skirmisher is going to attack him. And the basic attack value is 3, plus a response card, which again averages out to about 2, so we probably want at least 5 defense. So yeah, let's go ahead and use Defensive Stance for 0 action points and get 5. And the Skirmisher, ooh, he gets over our defense, gives us a wound card, which in this case is a very minor one, a flesh wound. We can just throw it into any attack, and it won't affect it really at all. So that's easy to get rid of, thank God. Oh wait, silly me, if only I was so lucky. The Skirmisher has a 2 attack value, which means I also get a contusion. Again, not a bad one, but it's going to limit how many cards I can draw this turn. All right, the second Skirmisher is coming after Eliza, since Bastion has 1 enemy engaged, and she does not. But she's not even going to try to block. She's just going to mind control him for 2 action points. The attack does not happen, and he gets sent back to the quest area. So bye-bye, little Skirmisher. So remember, the Huntmaster wanted to support the archers, but there aren't any, so he's going to attack, and oh no, he's going to go after Eliza too because she has nobody engaged. So he has a 3 attack value, but if he gets through, he does 3 wounds. So she's going to use both of these defense cards. That'll give her 9 defense. She does have to spend 1 action point, but then she gets to draw a card from her deck. That's another area of effect card. I need some actual attack boosters. All right, but 3 attack versus 9 defense. Yeah, no matter what he drew, it would have been okay. I wish that had gone to the other guy. So we survived, but that was a little nasty. All right, now we go to the spawn phase, and we add 2 enemies each turn in this scenario. We got another Skirmisher and another Archer. Man, I need to get some big attacks going here. And then it's the draw phase. So remember, they reset to their basic value, and then plus 1 for each card remaining, except for Eliza, it's plus 2, so that brings her to 13. That seems way better. And one nice thing the game does for you as it is crushing your soul is that wound and fatigue cards still count as cards for you figuring out your action points. So Bastion's actually at 12. Awesome. Then they're each going to draw 6 new cards and discard it down to 6, but Bastion has to keep his silly wounds. So let's see, I want the biggest attacks I can do. Anatomy lesson, that looks good. Swordsmanship, sure. Ooh, tactical genius can be played after the attack. Anyway, I think I'm going to keep my other one that can be played after the attack and just kind of go all in on damage this turn, hopefully. And on a positive note, like I mentioned, I'll be able to get rid of these wounds pretty quickly here. And we get to the end phase and go up to 2 threat, which will change the spawn next turn and get us a little closer to winning. And as for Eliza, we are praying we see one of her fireball cards. Yes. Okay. So these are kind of key to her whole attacking strategy. They have a 5 bonus attack. They do cost a lot, though. And if they deal damage with the attack, then the card comes back in your hand. So she can just use these over and over again as long as she has the points. Oh my gosh, I got both of them? So this makes things definitely tough, because I've got Fiery Frog and Torrent of Fire, which both add area of effect to my attack. Plus, I've got Blazing Winds as one basic attack. I sadly threw away the other one for my Throwing Dagger to survive that other guy's attack. So I'm certainly keeping both Fireballs. I don't think I need Dramatic Attack, although it does let me draw 2 cards. So I guess it'll more than replace itself. But I think I'll just forego defense and just deal with the consequences. And actually, you know what? Seeing what she drew, I'm going to have Bastion keep his Rally card. For one key thing, remember that Eliza struggles to get attacks off. He has this power to let a hero initiate a 2 damage attack, which she can still boost with her Area of Effect stuff. So I'm going to keep that and throw away one of these boosting his own attack cards. All right, on this note, let's see how crazy Eliza can go. So she's going to do Blazing Winds to start the attack. That's 2 action points down to 11. She's going to boost it with Torrent of Fire to attack 3 people in the same area for 5 more Gs. And then she'll use at least one of her fire boosters. That's 3 to get her down to 3. And that's 7 attack. That's almost definitely enough to hurt all the people I want to hurt. So let's stop there for the moment. And I guess I'll hit the archer, since the wound might take him out of being able to attack entirely, and the huntmaster and one of the skirmishers. So my 7 is set. We draw for each of them 1 plus 3, and then I'll shuffle the deck. So that's 4. The huntmaster got a 5, and the skirmisher got a 5. Awesome. I hurt all of them. Which means they each get a wound card. The archer, ooh, got 2 damage. He is dead straight away. Although I think I might have preferred that on one of the other guys. How about our huntmaster? Ooh, his defense and his attack is way down. I'm happy with that. And the skirmisher is similar. I don't think their range can go below 0, so I think he still has 1 range, but he has no defense, almost no attack, and is hurt. Very, very good. And remember the special power of the fireball. It goes back to my hand, but both of these are discarded. Now, sadly, she doesn't have enough action points to do another one of those big attacks, even if Bastion gives her that free attack. Oh, wait, I meant to play this. So I'll go ahead and add this to the attack. It's just 1 extra action point, and I get to draw 2 cards. No reason not to do that. Oh, desperation. Maybe I can attack some people. So look at this, I need to spend 2 action points, which is exactly what I have. I gain action points equal to 3 response card draws, but if any of the response cards have a red symbol on them, I also get a fatigue into my hand. But, I mean, I want to go big, right, and take care of some of these guys, so let's do it. All right, come on, high numbers and no red symbols. 3, that is great. Okay, and 1, whatever. Another 3, but no red, so awesome. 7 more action points and no red whammies on me. So she's back to 7. If he gives her the free attack, Fiery Frog is 4, and a Fireball is 3 more. Although, look, Fiery Frog says you may attack up to 1 target in your hero area and up to 2 enemies in another area, so I would really want to engage somebody to make that worth the most it can be. Oh, but wait, look, the Orc Skirmisher is down to 0 engagement cost. I think I can just pull him over for free. Perfect. I'm going to have Bastion play Rally for 2 action points. I'm going to have him let Eliza draw a card and then do a 2 range, 2 attack. Then for the attack, we'll do Fiery Frog, and Fireball uses up all her action points. So it's another 7 damage attack against 3 targets. Should be our 3 friends here. Okay, this guy has 0 defense, minus 1. That was kind of wasted on him. This guy's got 1 defense, plus 3, not enough. And this guy's got a full 3 defense, yes. So dead, and a wound. Okay, his defense is way down. His attack is a little bit down. Ooh, he's cheaper to engage with. Bastion can kill at least one of them, although probably not both. And since we cause wounds, the fireball comes back, which is awesome. She is actually going to have some pretty good action points next turn. Now, I don't think she'll be attacking much for a while because there aren't that many of those cards in her deck, but that was amazing. All right, sorry, Bastion, you've been hanging out waiting. So you got this Orc Skirmisher with full defense on you. Let's go ahead and spend 2 attack to do Anatomy Lesson for 5. And we could boost it 3 more if needed, but we'll start with 5. So 3 defense. Ooh, plus 5. Oh, no. That's 8 defense. So even if I boost it 3, it won't be enough. That's just a wasted attack. But hey, there aren't that many 5s in the deck, so I guess we'll go for it again. A 5. Plus 1. That's much better. So we don't even need a Tactical Genius. And ooh, apparently I lied. There are cards that don't have damage, so I should be drawing 4 of my enemies from now on. My bad, everybody. But yeah, that means the Orc Skirmisher is not dead. He's just very, very hurt. And oh, silly me. Of course I would have added on both of these. They cost nothing, and they're out of my hand. So all I've got is Tactical Genius. I might as well spend 3 to draw a card and maybe do that again. Okay, Tower, that's a nice defense card. Let's do it again. And Battle Insight. Oh, you know, I forgot. Whenever I receive a wound through an attack, I can return 1 card with an attack action from my discard pile to my hand. Well, too late for that, but I'll try to remember next time. All right, so I've got 1 action point left and now some defense. I think I'll just sit and see what happens. Okay, only 2 skirmishers left at the moment. And they're doing a 2 activation, which means they're going to engage or attack if they're already engaged. So I guess this orc did not appreciate being burned almost to death, so here he is. And this guy's going to attack Bastion with 0 attack power. So let's go ahead and use Tactical Genius for 4 defense. And oh man, shuffle the deck again, but we got a +3, so he did not get through. And let's not forget our powers this time. I could discard another defense card like Tower to draw a replacement, but we're about to get barraged in a second during the spawn phase with arrows, so I want to keep that, I think. Speaking of the spawn phase, we do indeed get 2 more people, another Huntmaster and another Skirmisher. Lots of those guys. And then yeah, in rounds 2, 4, and 5, we take automatic attacks. So each of us is taking a 2 damage attack. This was not great planning on my part. Only Bastion has a defense card. But remember, when he gets hurt, he gets bonuses. And Tower has 2 range and 0 cost. So I'm actually going to play the 6 defense on Eliza. So Bastion runs in and raises his big shield, and it does nothing. No! So despite his best efforts, Eliza got injured with a terror card. The only way to get rid of it is to spend 5 action points. Give me a break. Now, the nice thing is it's an extra card, so it's going to give her 2 more action points, but still not great. And then Bastion spent so much time unsuccessfully defending Eliza that he got hit. Oh, and another action point 1 knee wound. That's harder for him to deal with. I might just have to keep that for a while. But whenever he gets hurt, he gets to get an attack card back automatically. Let's get this 1 cost, 5 attack 1. That seems pretty great. And we're going to round 3. No barrage in this round, which I'll actually try to remember this time. Okay, in the draw phase, so Bastion's up to 9 action points, 6 plus 3 cards. Eliza is up to, 5 times 2 is 10, plus 5, 15. Wow. Although she's going to discard a ton of cards right here. Let's see, she's got 2 of her main attack cards. She's got an ally that can block for her, an attack that'll give her extra action points. This one can engage and disengage enemies. I don't think we need that. And I think the 2 attacks plus her fireballs are, of course, good to keep. And then, you know what, I'm actually going to keep this Void Key card because that lets her keep a card after she uses it, like one of her main attack cards. So she'll just have a ton of big attacks and her terror. He got a ton of defense. Ooh, that's a 5 attack. Provoke lets me engage or disengage people pretty easily. Quick Cleave lets me hit multiple people. That might be a good combo. So I'll definitely get the big attack. I'll definitely keep the Cleave. You know, I think I'll get this Veteran's Eye because it gives me action points to get rid of that knee wound, maybe, and just have no defense like a moron. All right, let's have Eliza deal with her Skirmisher first. I'm going to play this Void Key for 1 action point out of 15. And again, that'll let her discard that instead of discarding a card she used in an attack. And then even though she probably doesn't need to do this much because his defense is reduced to 0, she can do a fire dance with a fire spell that is 2 plus 3, 5 action points. I mean, I just don't want to miss, right? So that's down to 9 she has. Okay, and his defense is definitely not up to the task. Yeah, dang, could have gotten away with just the fire dance. Okay, no special effects here. He's definitely dead. And I'm keeping both of those cards because I'll discard the Void Key to keep fire dance, and fire spell comes back since I dealt damage. Alrighty, she could probably do another one of those, or yeah, just one more. So sure, let's do another fire dance with a fireball. And against our new Huntmaster friend. So 8 attack, 3 defense, plus 0. Sorry, buddy. And oh, it just lowered his attack. That's a pretty weak wound effect. I keep the fireball, lose the fire dance this time. And I have no way to get action points, do I, to do another big attack. And I definitely can't get rid of the terror. Well, you know what? It wasn't the plan, but whatever. I think Bastion's going to give her 3 action points. Sorry, Bastion. He knows who's really bringing the pain in this arrangement. So that's going to be Burning Hands for 2. And a fireball for 3 more, and we'll see how it goes. We're going to try to finish off this Huntmaster with a 7 attack. Yes, we are getting all these great draws. So let's draw for it. Okay, and indeed, he is dead. And once again, get the fireball back, but she is totally out of stuff she can really do. I'm worried about her having no defense. Let's do 1 action point to discard 1 or 2 cards. I'm realizing I don't really need both of these. Attacks don't need that much boosting. So let's draw a replacement. There we go, a defense. That sounds good. All right, Bastion, sorry, buddy. I'm not trying to ignore you. I think if he can just take out his Orc Skirmisher, that's probably good enough. And the nice thing is that guy has 0 defense. This Cleave ability I mentioned lets me either target 2 different enemies or target the same enemy with -2 attack on the second attack. So that raises the question, do I pull the other Skirmisher over or do I just attack twice? I think I'll just try to double attack this Skirmisher. So I guess my Trained Strike for 1... That's 5 attack, which means with his 0 defense, the first attack he would need to get a 5 to block it, and then the second attack he would need to get a 3. And I've got Battle Insight to boost 1 if that happens. So I'll spend 2 action points, do the cleave against him. So against the 5 attack, 4, awesome, that's 1 wound, and not -2. Guy's pretty messed up. How about our second one? Yes, with the 3 attack, he is defeated. Well, maybe, because I got a draw, and yes, there we go. Bastion pretty much just butchered that guy. Okay. So I've got some defense to take on the other guy, but I really want to get rid of this knee wound. So let's do that. 1, 2, 3, 4. Bye-bye. And that means now I'm the character with the fewest cards in hand, so the skirmisher will attack me if there's a choice. And I've got defense to deal with him, so I'm going to stop, I think. And when I forgot, you can use leftover action points to block, so I can give myself +2 defense with that. Nice. All right, definitely feeling good with how we're managing these guys. He gets a 3. Oh, of course, that was the one where he engages end attacks. They keep on getting lucky. Here he comes. But Bastion's ready. He'll play his 4 defense, and then +2 action points makes it 6 defense. Bring it on, dude. -1, that's not going to do it. So he successfully blocked, could discard a defense card to draw a replacement. That's not going to happen. We're into another spawn phase. 2 more enemies, an archer and another huntmaster. And no arrows on round 3, so Eliza's going up to 11 action points. That terror is still sitting there. Bastion's up to only 7, although, hey, this card can give him 5 more. And Bastion's going to draw 6 cards, and ooh, something we didn't talk about. Whenever you go through your entire deck, you add 2 fatigue cards. And just to show what they look like, they're always -2 attack or -2 defense or -2 action points. Oh, but here's the key thing, and I totally forgot to say this. Fatigue cards go away when you use them, but wound cards do not. So whoops, let's see. I had a knee wound for Bastion, and he previously had a flesh wound and a contusion. So those are going to keep on coming up now that he's reshuffling his deck. So let's just throw 2 fatigue in the mix. Yay! But he didn't draw any of them for that last card. So let's see, he only has to get rid of 1 of these. A shield wall is a great one to defend a lot of people, and there's going to be one of those arrow attacks this turn, so we definitely want that. We got an attack that can be played after, a defense that can go on either of us. Tactician lets us get some nice bonuses, a bunch of action points. So yeah, I think I'll get rid of gut feeling for the extra action points. And Eliza didn't get rid of her wound, but she is also adding 2 fatigue cards to her discard before she reshuffles and draws 6. I don't know if she got one, so she's going to have to keep that, and then +6 other cards. She's got one of her good basic attacks. A spell I don't care too much about. Desperation, maybe. The ally, I'm not sure. The void key I like. So definitely keep void key and throwing dagger and a fire spell. That'll let me get off 2 nice attacks. So that's 5. And then honestly, I think she'll need the defense to survive. So that's 6. So looking, we've got a skirmisher on Bastion, a huntmaster and an archer in the quest area. And we're going to each suffer a 4 damage attack at the end of this round. So we need to keep that in mind. So I'm going to have Eliza try to attack the archer. He's only got 1 defense, so we could probably tone it down a little bit. But now, whatever. We're going to do 2 and 3 for fire spell with a throwing dagger. That is 8. Yeah, he can't possibly defend. And no, he doesn't. And a gut wound. Oh, perfect. Yes. So I'm so happy because specifically with archers, their AI never has them engage anybody. They either disengage, run away from engagement, or they try to attack. And now this guy can never do anything because he's never going to get close enough to actually hit us. Basically, we broke his bow or just made him cry. So you're, for all intents and purposes, dead, archer. Thanks. And I'm sorry, I meant to play my void key for 1 so I can keep my throwing dagger spell. So both of these come back and that's gone. Oh, I should have used my fatigue. I'm not going to cheat and say I did, but yes, I could have easily taken -2 to that attack and still been fine. And then, you know, I think I could do another big attack or I could get rid of the terror. Let's attack the huntmaster for 8. And let's take a chance. How much defense does he have? 3? Yeah, let's bring it down to 6, I guess, to get rid of the fatigue. And the fatigue goes away entirely, remember? This could be really bad if I miss. Yes, he only has 4 defense. Come on, be nice to me. Just give me 2 damage. No, but he does have -1 defense. His shoulder is frozen by my fire. Okay. So I keep the fire spell, but the dagger is gone. And Eliza's out of action points, but she's got her defensive ward, and she hurts both those guys. That's cool. All right, how about you, Bastion? So the big thing I want to do is I want to save 2 action points so that I can play Shield Wall. It'll give both of us a response card draw for defense this round, so we'll have a chance to block stuff without playing any cards, and it'll give him 7 defense for 1 attack. But first, let's try to kill this skirmisher. Although, man, I really don't have very big attacks, do I? Well, you know what? Let's go ahead and play Tactician for 2, have him draw some cards. I think that's probably the best use of this. So 1 is a fatigue, awesome, and 2 is a non-attack card. Thanks so much. Well, I guess I can add these cards as needed. So let's start out with Battle Insight. Although I want to add a fatigue, I need to have at least 1 attack. Okay, so we'll spend 2 to do Sword Spin. Add the fatigues. Right now it's a 1 attack. And if the skirmisher draws, great, we'll just give up. Ooh, he only drew a 1, so he has 4. Which means I'd still have to use both of these to hit him. I mean, I think I'll just say I got rid of the fatigue and that'll be my bonus here. Well, no, that's dumb. That's dumb. Let's go ahead and pay 1 and use both of these and I do wound him. Okay, so he's down to 0 defense, 0 engagement cost, and 1 health. I got a bunch of nice defenses left. I'm going to go ahead and activate my shield. I'm going to keep the two action points to activate shield wall in a second. You know what I am going to do, since their disengagement cost is zero, and maybe I'm wrong, it has to be a minimum of one. I don't remember what the rule said. I'm going to engage the archer for free, since he doesn't want to be engaged with us, and going to disengage the orc skirmisher, and hopefully that'll muck things up for how the AI plays out. All right, so enemy phase, they got a four. So first, the skirmisher is going to engage or intimidate if already engaged, which would make us discard cards. So that worked out well. He'll engage Eliza, since she doesn't have any enemies yet. Then the Huntmaster will support skirmishers and all skirmishers attack. Dang it. So support means he comes to where the most of them are, so he's joining the skirmisher. I don't like this. And the skirmisher is attacking, and oh, his defense is not reduced at all. Well, that's okay. That's what we were saving shield wall for, so he's going to give her 7 defense, and she gets a response card. We all get a response card for the rest of this round. So here's his attack, plus 2, so he's at 5, and she's at 7, plus 3, 10 defense. Get out of here, skirmisher. Then the orc archer will disengage. I mean, it didn't matter, because he can't attack from 2 range anyway, but we're good. Run away, buddy. Then we get to the spawn phase, last 2 enemies, a skirmisher and an archer. We just need to survive. But now we each take a 4 damage barrage. Eliza will use her defense ward for 4 defense. So it's just going to be a response card against response card for the enemy. A 2 for her. A 2, yes, on a tie. We don't take damage. Good job, Eliza. And as for Bastion, he'll, I guess, do the same thing. 4 defense. Well, no, I don't want him to get hurt anymore, so let's do 8. All right, so the enemies have 6 total. And he, okay, he would have been fine with just the 4, but that's okay. He has 11, he's not hurt. But here's the bad part. He's going to have only 6 action points for the end of this round, and he just has to keep whatever he draws. Oh, his knee wound came back, acting up again. The rest looks pretty good. I mean, really, if we just defend and survive, we'll be okay. And Eliza's up to only 9 action points. She's still terrified, though. Okay, but she got only good cards. Did she get any of, like, her giant attack a bunch of people ones? No, she did not. All right, she got 2 basic attack cards. She got the attack bonus that lets her draw extra cards. I mean, this one lets her get extra action points. But then we are taking a big 6 attack barrage at the end of this round. So maybe she keeps some defense. Nah, you know what? Let's just go all in, because she's less hurt. And the thing about the campaign, kind of like Perdition's Mouth, is that wounds do kind of pay forward, and you have to deal with them. But I think you get to get rid of 3 wounds at the end of this scenario. So she can afford to take like 1 or 2 more without anything being too bad. And I'm going to have Eliza go first. She's got a skirmisher engage with her with 0 attack. Let's try our luck. Let's try our luck and do a fire dance without boosting it. So it's just 3 attack. On average, he will be hurt by that. And I'll use dramatic attack to let me draw 2 more cards and feint attack to let me get a bunch of bonus action points. Well, you know, we're forgetting the bonus action points. Never mind. I will spend 3 to make it a fire spell and make it an 8 attack so he can't possibly defend. I guess it wasn't necessary, only a 2. So the fire spell comes back, but I'm drawing 2 cards and then getting 2 action cards worth of bonuses. Oh my gosh, a 4? Okay, so 5 action points. She's up to 9. 2 more cards, my other fireball and telekinesis. And I didn't draw a wound. Yep, he is dead. So we've only got 4 guys left. Remember, this archer is basically out of contention. We can ignore him. So it really just comes down to these 3 guys and the big barrage at the end. Well, let's see. I think probably the best one is to finish off this Huntmaster. Although we saw he very rarely attacks. Maybe I have her shoot at the archer and just hope we get lucky with the response card. So yeah, let's do that. Burning Hands, that's 2, and a fireball for 3 more. I mean, that is 7. He's got 1 defense. That'll be enough. And indeed it is. Come on, give me a good wound. No, that's like the most worthless thing I've ever seen. Oh my gosh. Okay. Well, since we're going into the end of the turn, I just need defense. So I'm going to spend 1 action point to discard both of my fire spells and get some other stuff. That's useless. Let's try that again. Just trying to cycle through to... Come on. Now, she did get an attack. Should I try to kill off that archer? Sure. For my last 2 action points, I'm going to have her play this for 2 attack with a 0 bonus. What a waste this is. I'll get to draw 2 cards, though. Oh, wait. This is dumb. Let me have Bastion pull him over for 2 action points, and then they can do the attack together. So she's got 2, and she's given herself 2 card draw, and he'll assist, since the guy's at 1 range now, with, I guess, the surprise cut for 4. Now it's a 6 attack versus 1 armor, easily gone. And that's better. He is dead. And that lets Eliza draw 2 more cards. Hopefully their defense. Yes! And ooh, mind control, but she doesn't have enough action points to use it to cancel somebody's attack. Well, let's see. How's Bastion looking? He's got a ton of defense, which is what I want. Ooh, can any of these? Yes, 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 yes. Okay, I'm going to play guard on Eliza to hopefully give her enough action points to use mind control. So it's a card draw plus 1. Okay, that's the minimum she needed, but that's enough. Besides that, should Bastion try to attack somebody? You know what I'm going to do instead? I'm going to try to replace some cards and dig for defense. So let's do that. Ooh, let's go ahead and play Fade, since that'll give me action points back. Or no, I don't want to do that because I don't want to lose the card. So I'll dig again. Yes. Oh, I do need one action point to play that. So I think I'll stop here with three good defenses and one action. All right, so we just need to survive the enemy phase and the barrage, and we are out of here. A two. Okay, the skirmisher engages or attacks. Awesome. So he's going to run over to Bastion. The Huntmaster supports archers, and all archers disengage or intimidates one. So they ignore actions that would not change the board state at all. In this case, the archers can't disengage, and he can't move to where the most archers are. So instead, he's going to intimidate one, which means she loses her mind control, but that's okay. Then the archer tries to attack, but has insufficient range. So awesome. We just have to survive this big attack at the end. She's got 8 defense, and I keep on forgetting action points. She can boost it to 9, and it's a 6 attack. How's he looking? He can give himself 6, 9. Okay, and then he's the one with more wounds, so I'm going to make him a whole 15. So Bastion's safe no matter what, but 6 plus 3 is 9. She blocks as well, and we get out of there. And again, that mattered because we only get to heal 3 wounds at the end of the mission, so she'll get rid of her terror. And Bastion can get rid of his knee wound and his contusion, and his flesh wound comes out almost squeaky clean from the battle. Nice. And at the end of this mission, like most missions, we would probably gain something like the axe I showed you, and Bastion could take and replace his right hand items and have a ton of cool attack and defense powers. So there you go. That was Beyond the Rift, either on Kickstarter now or coming soon. And if you want to hear my thoughts on the game so far, just hang on. So all right, Beyond the Rift. What do I think about this one? Especially since I didn't love Perdition's Mouth personally. So first, the good things. I tend to love resource management games. And I think the interplay of action points and cards in your hand here is really fun, especially once you know your hero and kind of know what their deck contains. Like Eliza, I kind of know how many attacks she can get off. And they have a lot of nice mitigation options, like being able to spend action points to draw more cards, being able to spend cards to get more action points, being able to cycle cards from your hand to draw more from your deck at the cost of going through your deck more quickly and gaining fatigue. I think that all works really well. And you have interesting options with the cards because they're a resource you can spend to do other effects. You can boost cards. I like the little combos you can do with attacks. Sometimes you can defend each other. I like the aiding, and there's a lot of kind of cooperative aspects, not just in how you pool enemies, but how you boost each other. So yeah, just like kind of the challenge of figuring out what you want to do with these, I think is great. And then on top of that, at least in the prototype they sent, there are 4 different characters with completely unique decks and mechanics that feel really different. And you can play this true solo, but I still think probably two-handed will be the best. So like mixing and matching and playing through the campaign with different people seems really cool. Another thing I really like is the wound mechanic. Now, I do want to say this has the potential to get maybe too punishing over the course of a whole campaign. Like I came out of that scenario kind of luckily without taking any damage. But if things had gone badly and I had like 2 or 3 wounds just kind of chilling in my deck for the next mission, that'll make things tough. I think that mechanic could be really fun for those who like kind of the challenge of surviving and the tension ramping up and up. But I could also see it being kind of a poor get poorer mechanic where if like one scenario goes really poorly, you might have to deal with this stuff. But I think the overall choices you have to deal with these wound cards are great. I also like the enemy activation. Now, hopefully this will be on a card or like in a quest booklet or something to make it a little simpler so I don't have to print it out. But the way enemies activate is very simple. There is some strategy in knowing like what enemies are likely to do what and kind of preparing for it with the engagement and stuff, trying to get like the attacks to go to the right people. So again, I think all of that is working really well and is pretty straightforward. Now the response deck, I think, does its job. It might frustrate some people because if you do like a huge attack, you lose a lot of stuff. That's probably the most negative thing about this, that it's kind of so all or nothing. If you play like 3 cards and they get the exact right high defense card to block your attack, you're not only out like those action points, you also lose all those cards you put in. So there's certainly going to be a feeling of like punishment and randomness in here, but I think you need that tension to make the game work. Now, as for the scenario design itself, it seems pretty cool. This one was a straightforward battle, just trying to survive, but some of the other ones I've played, you have to like rescue people while you're fighting or explore these doors, and each time you open up a door, you get more enemies, so you kind of decide the pace yourself. So I think that's working pretty well. And the threat tracker tends to keep things like kind of moving at a good pace. You never have too much of a lull. But full disclosure, they're still developing the missions and I've only played 3 of them. So I'm not sure how the whole campaign will feel, if it'll feel super varied. There are other decks of enemies like cultists and creatures. If you've played Perdition's Mouth, you'll be familiar with those. So if they have enough variety there, I think it could have some nice replay. And the order things come out and playing the characters tends to, I think, make it feel different each time. So besides maybe some concern about scenario development, just hoping they get it right, and the potential randomness of the response deck, is there anything I don't like? I would say probably the biggest thing I hope they do is a bit of a graphic design retool. Like, I like the art in the middle of this Orc Huntmaster, but this is by far the most important information on the card, and it's a little bit hard to see down here. Now, I get why they have it down there, because they want those wound cards to match up, but could we, like, you know, raise this up and make each of these icons bigger? There's a lot of white space in between them. I feel like that might be something they should look into. And the other thing to note right now, I'm not sure how much of this is going to change, is that there are a lot of cool cards, but not a lot of art assets. Look, so your character cards have no art, except for on your player board, you have a picture of yourself. The terrain cards have no art. I have to imagine they're going to add stuff in for this. You didn't see these in this mission, but these are used for like terrain and objective things. And then the wounds have no art. So, you know, it's okay. I don't know if I want a giant picture blocking up the effects for these kind of things. But just a note, if you want like tons of evocative art the entire time you're playing, right now the game is definitely more kind of utilitarian in how they do it. But all that being said, this one definitely impressed me. I like it more than Perdition's Mouth so far. I think the campaign with the leveling up, dealing with the wounds and fatigue, getting new items is really cool. I think the scenario design is pretty varied so far. I think the choices of how you use your cards and your action points is very tough. The enemies run super smoothly. There's great cooperation. Lots of good stuff here. So definitely recommend you check out the Kickstarter once it's up and see what you think. Good gaming, everyone, and I'll see you at the next stop.